Y'all got it.
Good morning. I'm so privileged to welcome you this morning on this Sunday morning. We're a little shy of some folks, especially in the choir. Some of us went to family camp for the weekend. I just went yesterday for the day. So if you look around and see some really familiar faces not here, they are at family camp today. So glad to see you here. And we have visitors this morning. They're all sitting over on my left side of the building. Hope you will give them a warm First Presbyterian welcome when church is over. Just one announcement about business. Christian Education Committee will meet this week at 5 o'clock as opposed to next week. And several people have already commented about the flowers in front of the communion table. Are they not beautiful? Thank you, Susan Andrews. They are just gorgeous. And they are live, and the plan is to change them out routinely as needed. Isn't that wonderful? Thank you so, so much. It's just a beautiful addition to the building. We are thankful for that. I think that's all I have. I invite you to take this time and prepare your heart to worship God. Please join me in the opening prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord we pray. Amen. Be seated. I invite the children, well, that would be one child, to come to the front. Mr. Milo. Mr. Milo tells me he turned six back in May and we didn't even know it. We can still sing. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Milo. Happy birthday to you. Thank you. So cute. You can sit down. You can sit down. I've been told to stand over here. Do you know what this is? Doc McStuffin. Do y'all know Doc McStuffin? Here we have Doc McStuffin, and I'm so sorry. Lily was here for Sunday school, and then the rest of them are at family camp to hear this. Doc McStuffin. Okay, here we have. Actually, I thought about getting some of our resident doctors to come up here and do this. Well, I'm not very good with such. Okay, Milo, let's check your heart. I don't think it's beating. Oh, no, it is. It's beating. Your heart's beating. I can hear it. Actually, this thing had some little contraption in it that made a sound every time you made a move. I had my husband take it out. We did not want to hear that. Okay. Take your temperature. Under your arm. Hold up your arm. Okay. Nope, no temperature. Aren't you glad? So that means you don't have to get a shot. Since you don't have any temperature, we don't have to get a shot. I cannot tell you how many times I've been shot with this thing. Or my heart checked. Okay. Did you know that Jesus was a doctor?
Yeah.
You did?
Yeah.
I really never put much thought into this. Jesus was a doctor, the great physician, and Jesus cured all kinds of people.
He was a healer.
He was a healer. Thank you so much. He was a healer. And he cured all kinds of people, and the Bible tells us all about all the people he cured, that he doctored on. And so today we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about a little girl and then an older lady, and he healed both of them. So that's what we're going to talk about. You know, it would be interesting to do a study on all of the healings in the New Testament, of which there were many. And most of them, do you realize this? People unnamed. Actually, we don't have very many names of people that were healed. It was just sort of, he healed the blind and the lame and the... We don't really have a lot of names, but Jesus healed a lot of people. So we're going to talk about that today. Is that what you talked about in Sunday school? Okay, well, you were supposed to talk about that. Whether they did or not, I don't know. Let's pray. We thank you, God, that you are still the great physician. And we lean on you for healing. Bless us today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Okay, Mr. Milo. We come to this time of confession on Sunday morning because we need to be healed from our sins, forgiven and renewed and restored. And God has offered us a chance to ask for forgiveness during this time. So we will read together the printed prayer and then take a few moments in silent confession. Let us pray. Lord, we come to you, our hearts made heavy from the weight of our sin. You have created us in your image. You have blessed us with every goodness. You have been our God throughout the years. Yet we turn away from you, deny your presence, and mistreat one another in the name of self-interest. Forgive us. In your mercy, relieve us from the burden of sin. Lead us yet again toward the light of your truth, and empower us to live as your people. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Hear now the sins that we have confessed in the silence of our hearts, forgiving us and renewing us for your service. In the forgiving name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Is hymn number 458. Our scripture reading today is taken from the 5th chapter of Mark, beginning with the 21st verse. I invite you to listen to the word of God as it comes to you today. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him. And a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had. And she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any farther?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, they saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make such a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha cum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. And again, he went to the other side. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please join me in prayer again. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on all of us. For we ask this in the name and in the spirit of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Some of us are old enough to remember when doctors made house calls. Okay, who remembers when doctors made house calls? Cordell? Well, your daddy was the doctor. That doesn't count. Oh, Dr. Rory came to your house. Okay. Well, a fair number of us remember when doctors made house calls. Sweet Dr. Hay was our doctor, and bless his heart, he made many a house call to the three of us. And I well remember he had one diagnosis. One diagnosis, and he said, "Well, it's a virus sort of thing." Well, I think he was right. It was a virus sort of thing, and then he had one remedy for your virus sort of thing, and that was to sip salt water. Have you ever heard of that? Well, you know what? We're here to tell about it. It worked. Sipping salt water. And dear John Calhoun used to say, if you will just sniff salt water, do you remember that? If you will just sniff salt water, it will cure all of your sinuses. Have not tried that. Jesus was the great physician who made house calls. And we have several stories in the Bible about that, in the New Testament, one of which I just read today. Earlier in Mark, it talks about the time Jesus went home with Peter, on the early disciples, and the mother-in-law was sick. So while he was there, he cured the mother-in-law, had a high fever, it said. And not only that, Jesus was a well-rounded general practitioner, we would say. He cured a lot of people of a lot of different things. He was not a specialist. Cured a lot of people of a lot of different things. Just before this reading, first part of the fifth chapter, it talks about the time Jesus went to the other side, and there he found a man who was possessed by demons. And the man was so possessed by demons, he was not allowed in the city. He lived in the cemetery. You remember that? He lived in the cemetery. So possessed he was. And Jesus healed this man, cast out the demons, and the demons ran into a herd of swine. And the swine went into the sea. He healed that man. Then straight after that, he was called by a man named Jairus, a leader of the synagogue, and he asked him to come to his house to cure his little daughter. He knew that Jesus could do that, to cure his little daughter, so he went. You know this story. And on the way, the woman who had hemorrhages touched his garment, and then she was healed, and then he went on and ultimately brought the little girl back to life. Jesus not only made house calls, he was a well-rounded physician. He just cured everybody from the lepers to the lame, cured them all. There's a lot of interesting points about this story that you probably don't even know, but one is, in the Greek especially, it uses the word saved and healed interchangeably. Those words are used interchangeably. So what does that mean to be saved and healed? And are they the same? Well, yes, in one sense, yes, they are. And I don't know if you noticed that the number 12 was used twice. The lady had suffered from hemorrhages for 12 years, and the little girl was 12 years old. Doesn't go without notice. And there's some other points about this story that I think are very interesting. One being, Jesus apparently didn't mind getting his hands dirty. And by that I mean, he didn't mind touching people who were ceremonially unclean, lepers. In this case, the woman was considered unclean because she suffered from bleeding, unclean. The little girl who, if you touched a corpse, you were considered unclean and had to go, according to the Levitical law, to the synagogue for the ritual cleaning. Jesus never cared about that. He didn't care about that. He just healed whoever was brought forth to him and didn't care about what their condition was or what that implication was for him. That now he was unclean. I'm not there yet. I have bottles of hand sanitizer all over my car. As soon as I get in the car, I get the hand sanitizer. But that didn't matter to Jesus. He just healed whoever came and whoever was brought to him. And another thing about Jesus in the healing stories is he didn't just heal important people or their families. Jairus was a very important man, a leader of the synagogue, and he came to Jesus and he was desperate for help. Please help my daughter. So Jesus was on the way to help this very important person. And in the middle of all that, he was stopped by a nameless woman. And you know, he could have just kept going. He knew that someone touched his garment. He just could have kept going, but he didn't. He stopped and he talked to her. Go your way. You've been healed. Jesus did not just minister to the people who were important, cater to the wealthy. It didn't matter who you were. And then there's another point that I think is even more important than those two things. Jesus always seemed to be interrupted. Always some kind of an interruption. He was in Jericho, and there was a big crowd of people in Jericho, and a little short man got up in a tree. You know that story. Interrupted the whole thing. And Jesus said, well, I think I'm going to go to your house and have dinner today. We could sing that song. In the middle of going to the home of this very important man, he took the time to stop and talk to this nameless woman who had already been healed. His was a ministry of interruptions. When I was on staff at First Presbyterian Church in Alexandria, Louisiana, I was the organist director and the Christian education director, did it all. And I remember well when I first started both jobs, wore both hats, that it seemed like the phone rang off the wall. People were in and out of my office all day. I didn't have time to do my work. So I would be there till 7 or 8 o'clock at night doing what I considered work. Well, some nice man was in my office one day and I began to complain. And I said to him, you know, I can't get my work done for all these people. I can't get my work done for the phone ringing and all these people walking in. The coffee pot was always on, as the commercial says. And he said to me, they are your work. They are your work. The papers can wait. The committee can wait. They are your work. He was right. But of all of those things, Jesus didn't mind getting his hand dirty. He didn't cater only to the wealthy. He had a life of interruptions. As important as all those are, I don't think that's the most important, or to me at least. 3 times in chapter 4 that Danny Gray talked about last week, it said Jesus got in the boat with the disciples and said, let's go to the other side. And that's when the storm hit and he calmed the storm. In chapter 5, twice, it said Jesus went to the other side. First, he found a man who was possessed by demons. Second, a child and a woman. When he went to the other side. I, like you, have been to the other side. I have stood on the other side of the empty grave. And so have you. Overcome with grief. My sister and I, and some of my kids, suffer from what we call the demons in the night. Do you know the demons in the night? The anxiety and the worry and the fretting over things that for the most part we can't even control. Those demons in the night that wake you up and you can't go back to sleep. And the illnesses, and the hurting, and the suffering. We all know all about that. The other side, we've been to that side. And if this story tells us anything, it tells us that when we get to the other side, which we inevitably will, when we get to the other side, Jesus is there. We cannot go to the other side without the presence of Jesus already being there. I never realized that about this story. Jesus met them at the other side. And he will meet us there too. Amen and amen. I invite you to stand and we will say together what we believe about God as we say the words of the affirmation of faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated while the ushers come to receive our offering.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we acknowledge that every good gift and perfect gift comes from above. So we give you thanks for all that we already have. And we pray that you would make us cheerful givers in return, grateful for all that you have done for us. Please bless these tithes and offerings for the kingdom in this place, for it's in thy name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. You will find on the back of the bulletin people for whom we have been praying. Bob Ransdale is now at St. Michael Rehab, doing well, but he has a long way to go. So I know that Dean and Bob both would appreciate your prayers on their behalf. And I think that's the only new name that I have. So I invite you to take a few moments to pray silently before we pray together. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, you have taught us in your word to ask and it will be given, and seek and we shall find, a knock and the door will be opened. But we confess that sometimes we ask and think we have not received. We seek and we believe we have not found. And we knock, and we believe the door is still shut. But we also believe that your caring for us and your love for us is beyond our understanding and beyond measure. And we also believe that even when we think we have not been given, and we think we have not found, and we think that the door has not been opened, in fact, you are always moving in the direction of our good, working for our good, even when we are unaware. We thank you for the beauty of this day and the beauty of this place. I thank you for these people and their faithfulness to you and the church. We continue to be thankful for the country in which we live and the freedoms that we have, the freedom even to be here today. We pray as always for these whose names we have called and for those who are listed. We pray that your nearness and your peace and your comfort and your wholeness would be with them today. And once again, we ask that you would hear us as we ask. You would guide us as we seek. And that you would be there to hear as we knock on your door. Hear the prayers we have made in silence and the prayer we make together, the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
will take the time to welcome our visitors today before we leave. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you on this day and forevermore. Amen.